stretch. Let's take a deep breath.
Put your shoulders back, lift your chin.
Exhale the chin down.
You can do this.
Now,
and something shifted,
right,
and I went on with my day. And the next morning, I walk into my bathroom, and this is the other weird
now,
thing about the high five.
I've
literally either criticized myself or ignored myself in the mirror for decades. When you start to have a moment with yourself, the crazy part is you start to build a partnership with yourself. Like, you know, when you are pulling out of your driveway or you're walking down the street and you see a neighbor and they greet you, you will start to have that experience when you create this intentional moment with yourself in the mirror every morning. And so as I started to do this, I thought, this is actually making me feel like the wind is at my back when I leave the bathroom. It's making me feel just like when you leave a huddle in sports and you high five, or you're a runner running a race or doing some big endurance challenge and some spectator high fives you, or another racer's like, come on, you got this, as you're dragging down low. It gives you a little energy. Like, I think too about this high five a lot. Like, I know, you know, you're friends with David Goggins. I'm a huge fan of Goggins. And so, and I know there's a lot of people that watch this show, especially men, that are like, this sounds kind of stupid. This is the equivalent of Goggins' cookie jar moment. So we all think, like, we've all been raised like, tough love, hard on myself, this bullshit. The research is clear on this. Being hard on yourself is not fucking motivating. It's demotivating. And if you already feel like a failure, or you feel a sense of shame, or you're overwhelmed, beating yourself up for where you are does not fucking work. It drives you into the gutter. The most motivating force in the world, on the planet, based on research, hands down, is empowerment, encouragement, support, and celebration. And for our entire lives, we have outsource that to somebody else. The research is very clear. So the NBA study, they did this big study looking at NBA teams, and they could predict in the study who was going to be in the championship rounds based on, in the preseason, what teams had the most high fives, fist bumps, and back pats. Why? Because those kind of gestures create partnership and trust. And I'm here to tell you, when you start doing it in the mirror, you're creating partnership and trust with yourself. And so, you know, one of the things that I love about this is that in a moment when you feel alone, you can give yourself the boost, the support, the empowerment that you need to keep going. And here's another piece of research that's also like, holy cow. You're a big proponent of the growth mindset. You guys talk about it all the time on this show, right? So researchers wanted to know, what is the most empowering way to motivate kids through a really big challenge, okay? They divide the kids into three groups. This takes the marshmallow test to a whole other level. You got one group of kids that are doing a challenging task, and they're getting the fixed mindset praise, which we all know does not work. Oh, Tom, you're so smart. Oh, Tom, I love your glasses. That's going to help you. Oh, Tom, you got a great smile. Oh, Tom, you know, I just love so much about you. I know you can do this. So that's one group. The second group gets the growth mindset kind of praise. Tom, you are such a hard worker. Tom, your perseverance is unbelievable. Tom, you just keep going. That does better, obviously, than telling you that you're smart, because it makes you motivated to work hard. The third group, they just got a simple high five. The researchers didn't even say anything to the kids. They just walked up and gave them a high five. The group of kids that got a simple high five outperformed, outworked through all of the challenges, all of the other forms of praise. Why? Because a high five is something deeper than praise. It fulfills your most fundamental needs as a human being. When somebody high fives you, you feel seen, you feel heard, and you feel like somebody has acknowledged you for the unique person that you are. Let's just talk for a second about the things that go viral. You can always find going viral. A teacher standing outside of a classroom doing what? Greeting kids with individual handshakes. And we see that, and we're like, oh, that's amazing. Why? Because every one of those kids, before they walk into the classroom, feels seen. They feel heard. And they feel acknowledged for the unique individual that they are. All through a simple handshake or high five. And one of the reasons why I'm so excited about this is because very casually on the story, you know, in the very beginning, because I've been researching this now for a year. I started to get back all of the objections that people had to doing it. And they're fucking sad, Tom. And this gets to the heart of why I think so many people are stuck. One of the biggest objections that people had to standing in front of the mirror, take a moment, look at yourself, and then raise your hand, is people said over and over and over again, I haven't done anything worthy of high-fiving. High-fiving feels like a celebration. I don't have the number on the scale that I want. I don't like my bank account. I don't enjoy what I do for a living. I've made a shitload of mistakes. I'm struggling with trauma. I don't have anything to celebrate. And what I realized is people are making a fundamental mistake. You are withholding the very support, empowerment, and celebration that you need to change and to do the hard work and to face the things that you're scared of. And that's why you're not changing.
This is so interesting. So I'm going to push you on this. I'm super curious because one of the things I love about you is you're so blunt and honest about, hey, if you want to have self-worth, you have to do things. You think you're worthy. I'm a huge proponent of that. And yet I do recognize that you have to let yourself off the hook to really get started. So how do you help people anchor on something? Is it just, hey, it's the fucking neurochemistry of the situation, you have to do it?
Yeah, very much. Because if you can't stand in front of a mirror and raise your hand and high-five yourself just because you got your ass out of bed and you're breathing, you will never get what you want in life, ever. There is something in the resistance to it. And if you unpack the resistance, you will find the reason why you don't have what you want. You either think you're not worthy of it, or you think that it's kind of stupid, or you have been brought up to believe that for women in particular, you're going to be bitchy or selfish or not likable if you're celebrating yourself. There is something in the resistance to you simply cheering for yourself.
So talk to the person, though, that so as of right now, they really believe the world has shown them that they aren't worthy. It's not like they question it. They know it to be true.
Yeah.
How do you help people? Because I recognize that as a lie, or even if it's true, it's useless.
Right.
But how do you help people out of that moment?
So the first thing that I would say is, how is treating yourself as if you're unworthy helping you? Like, let's just get strategic and common sense about it. Is the negative shit you're saying and the support that you're withholding helping you feel better? If it's not, try this. Try celebrating yourself 5 days in a row. Literally, try starting your day by waking up and raising your hand and high-fiving yourself in the mirror. Just because you're breathing. And see what happens. We have a woman that wrote to us who's in a domestic violence shelter. She's lost everything. She's been in abusive relationships. She has a tremendous amount of childhood trauma. She is doing the high-five habit, and here's what she had to say about it. I have nothing right now. I have a tremendous amount of evidence from my life that I have fucked everything up. But you know what this high-five habit is showing me?
That's it.
I still have me. I can have my back. I can be here for myself. The world has told me and convinced me that I can't, but every morning when I stand here and I stare at myself in the mirror and I raise my hand in defiance of all the shit that's happened to me, I keep going. I am saying I believe in myself. And when you have that small reversal, that small act of defiance, and that's what it is. If you're, like, heavy and you're eating emotionally or you're feeding your trauma, will you raise your hand and celebrate yourself even though you don't like what you look like? It's an act of fucking defiance to all the stuff that you have survived in your life. And the best part about it, you don't have to fucking say anything. And, you know, the reason why this is so important is most mantras are complete bullshit because you don't believe it. You know, we all know we need to accept ourselves. We all know we need to love ourselves. But how? How do you do it to your point when you have a bunch of evidence stacked up that you failed or reasons that you see that make you feel like you've blown it or you're not worthy of it? I'll tell you because beating yourself up will not make you do the work to get healthy. And tearing yourself down over the shit that you've done, the terrible relationships that you're in, it's not going to empower you to change the patterns that are keeping you stuck. But raising your hand in an act of defiance or a fuck you to the past that you survived and saying, I'm still here, which means I still have a shot to change my life. That is what this means.
There's another thing that you talk about in the book that I think ties this really well, which is the reticular activating system, the RAS. And you have this thing, which you say, you look for the hearts.
Yes.
And it's really an interesting psychological principle of you're going to see what you look for.
Yes.
And whether that's a red monster or whatever you say in the book, or whether that's a heart when you're walking around, whether that's a reason to love your wife, whatever. If you look for it, you're going to find it. And if it's a problem and a reason that you're, you know, a dirtbag and a reason that you're not worthy and all of that, you're going to see them and they will be there for you and they will overwhelm you. What is this idea of looking for hearts? What is that? How do people use it?
Okay, so I love this tool because obviously the high five in the air, it's like a Trojan horse. It's the beginning of building this partnership with yourself. And throughout the book, I then unpack all these other little tools and habits that you can use that are in this lane of empowerment, support, belief in self.
Okay, and I want to take a second to point this out. The book is rich with a bunch of other ideas. So
yes.
Anybody that's tempted to say, okay, well, I've already heard the high five myself and I'm done. You did a really good job with the, and to be honest, I'm not even sure, I guess because it was what unlocked things for you in your life, but there's like 15 things that you could have titled the book after.
Yeah.
So anyway, back to this.
So the reticular activity system, the RAS for short, for if you don't know what it is, picture a hairnet over your brain. That is a live network, and the RAS is a filter, and it has a huge job, and it is a filter that blocks out 99% of the world and lets in about, you know, 0.00000001%, and it is always changing. There are only four things, Tom, that get through the hairnet on your head. The sound of your name, and you've experienced this because you've been walking through a crowd and you're like, did somebody say my name? Right? The
cocktail party effect.
The second thing that gets through is any sort of threat. So if you hear a loud noise and you go like this, there are lots of noises you didn't hear, but the loud one you kind of duck because it's a threat. The third thing is when your partner is interested in sex with either you or someone else. That's right. Like, why are you checking that person out, right? You know, because the brain is letting that information in. The fourth thing, and this is where the transformation begins. Your brain will let in anything that it believes is important to you. The Zygarnik effect is the documented fact that when something is important to you, and I'll explain what that means. Your brain opens up a checklist in your mind. And now your brain, once it puts this item on your checklist, it will store the checklist in your subconscious. It's encoded in your RAS. And your mind is now on the alert to spot things related to it. The way that you make yourself feel like something is important is your nervous system goes on alert while you're thinking about it. You're either super excited about something, oh, this is super important, or this is the trauma effect. You go on alert and have something really bad happen, which is why things continue to bring it up throughout the rest of your life. So when you understand that if something's important to you, your filter will change in real time how you see the fucking world. You now know how to change your brain to work for you. And looking for hearts is the way I'm going to prove to you that this happens. I want to give you one other example because everybody's experienced this. If you've ever gone shopping for a new car or you've dreamt about having a new car, what happens immediately when you get excited about that new car is your mind goes, I can artifact, oops, okay, Tom wants the new Bronco. That's cool. So what do you see now? You see Broncos everywhere. Now, they were always there, but your mind is letting them in because the Zygarnik effect is now made it on a checklist. It's changed the RAS. And so I am going to prove to you that it is unbelievably cool that you can change the way that you view the world by looking for heart-shaped objects. So tomorrow when you wake up, you're going to start your day by high-fiving yourself in the mirror. I want you to examine what the resistance is about, because you're going to start to then be able to unpack what's holding you back. Then you're going to go out in the world, just like tell your mind, I want to see a heart today. Look for a rock. Look for a leaf. Look in your like latte. Is there a little shape there? Is there an oil stain on the floor? And when you see one, stop and go, shit, I'm like, there's a scavenger hunt. I never would have seen that before. Thank you, brain. Now your brain's like, more hearts. You will start to see hearts everywhere. And when you can start to train your brain and realize, whoa, this is actually a cool thing. This is high-fiving your mind. When you can see hearts, you can now go, wait a minute. If I can change what I see based on what I tell it, maybe if I got serious about not constantly saying I'm a failure, I wouldn't attach that or see it everywhere. Maybe if I got serious about saying, I can figure anything out, this is happening for a reason, instead of, I'm fucked, you say, okay, I'm going to learn something with this. It changes the way your brain filters everything. And this is such an important piece to the book, because we've all had the experience where you love somebody deeply, and you see all their incredible attributes. And all they see is failure. But all they see is the weight that they use. And it doesn't matter what you say. It doesn't matter what kind of pep talk or support you give them. Your loved one still only sees what they hate about themselves. Blame the filter in your brain. You have been bitching about your appearance or the weight on your scale, the fact that you're a failure for so long. Your brain believes it's important to you to see reasons why this is true. And one of the things I got to say about this, and everything in the book, is the tools are simple, Tom. But it's super important to say, just because you change and start celebrating yourself, it's not going to make the weight disappear suddenly. It doesn't change the number on the scale overnight. What it changes is you. And that changes your ability to deal with the problems and the issues you want to change in your life.
Let's talk about Athletic Greens, the all-in-one daily drink to support better health and peak performance. With so many stresses in life, it's difficult to maintain effective nutritional habits and give our bodies the nutrients it needs to thrive. Busy schedules, poor sleep, exercise, stress, or simply not eating enough of the foods that your body needs. That's where Athletic Greens can help. Their daily drink is like nutritional insurance for your body that's delivered straight to your door. Developed from a complex blend of 75 vitamins, minerals, and whole food source ingredients, Athletic Greens is a greens powder engineered to help fill the nutritional gaps in your diet. Athletic Greens continues to obsessively improve this one holistic formula based on the latest research, producing 53 iterations over the last decade and counting. It's lifestyle friendly, whether you be keto, paleo, vegan, dairy-free, or gluten-free, and contains less than 1 gram of sugar without compromising on taste. So many people on our team at Impact Theory are talking all about their experiences with Athletic Greens. They love the taste and how they can get the micronutrients from various veggies without having to cook or buy groceries. So when our marketing associate Chase is busy and knows he's not going to be able to easily eat any greens, he can bring along Athletic Greens and make sure that he's still getting adequate micronutrients from the powder without having to eat an entire farm's worth project that stuff offhand, but that there's actually information carried in those strong emotions.
Jealousy is one of the most powerful directional signals on the planet. Because you're only jealous of people that are doing things or have things that you actually want. It's impossible to be fake jealous. Whatever you're jealous of is hitting something deeply personal. Fucking pay attention to it. Instead of stewing in it, go, oh, flip it. That's interesting. I wonder why I'm jealous. What is it about it? Oh, it's that they're doing it consistently. It's that they've built a team. It's that they've aligned their work to so that they're spending more time with them. How can I take those things that I'm really now really inspired by and take action and go get them in my life? Because the thing about jealousy is, it's just your inspiration bucket blocked. Jealousy is sort of the insecurity that you have that blocks this inspiration. I guarantee you, back in the Uber driver, he's jealous of all the other actors earning Oscars. Because he's so inspired by the thought of doing that in his own life. But his insecurity is blocking action. His fear is blocking action. So instead of it being inspiration, it shows up as jealousy. And I'm here to tell you, the second you feel jealousy, stop. Okay, let's unpack that. What exactly is it about it? And now, if I were inspired by it, because there's enough success to go around for everybody, if I could use that as a roadmap to then go figure out how I might be able to do that for myself, wow. Talk about a game changer. And now let's add in the high five. What if every time I took a little step, I celebrated myself for just doing it? Now you're building small wins and momentum in a direction that's meant for you. That's how you change your life.
Getting people to understand that the idea that there's enough success for anybody, it doesn't matter if you're copying somebody for no reason other than the only thing that matters to life is, are you having fun? Is this a joyful life? Are you working hard at something that matters to you?
Yeah.
And whether or not it's even a carbon copy of somebody else, if you're having a ball, you've already won.
Totally.
And getting people to recognize, like, this is why I like your answer around, at some point you just have to accept your high-fiving yourself in the mirror because neurochemistry says that's what you need to do. Getting people to understand neurochemistry is the game. And once you understand the game that you're playing, then you can play it well. But if you don't understand the game, then you're going to get stuck. You're going to be stuck forever. And you talk a lot about taking responsibility for that, recognizing nobody's coming to save you. And something you said in the book, and something that you said in interviews, something that I absolutely think is really powerful. How do we use that? Why is that important to recognize?
Well, it's important to recognize because, first of all, nobody is coming. I mean, if you've been sitting around waiting for somebody to discover you, to pick you, to save you, to rescue you, to give you your shot, it's not fucking happening. Like, at some point, you gotta wake up and realize when you're 18 and you're out of that house, you have to parent yourself. Your life is your responsibility. And as a woman, one of the things that I found to be extraordinarily transformational is when I stopped, in a very traditional sense, looking to my partner to be responsible for providing for me. Providing financially, providing the support, providing, when I realized, wait a minute, it starts with me. I have to be able to figure out how to make myself happy. That's, by the way, the secret to a happy relationship. Marry somebody who's happy and work on your own happiness. And so when you stop outsourcing your happiness, your validation, your support, all of it, and you bring it back in, and you get responsible for it, it sounds scary. It's so liberating, because you could do anything. When you're responsible, when you're the driver of your life, when you're not looking out to anybody else to fix it for you, can you ask for help? Of course. But the buck stops with you. You're the one that has to do the work. You're the one who has to push your past. You're the one who has to figure out what makes you happy. You're the one who has to figure out, become self-aware about what you need. And then you're the one that has to find whatever it is, the courage or being humble enough to ask for help. Even if it's asking for help from biggest ally that you have, which is the person staring back at you in the mirror every damn morning.
I don't know why people are more obsessed with their goals. It's like, if my goals demand that I ask for help, then I'm going to ask for help. Like, I'm not even going to let anything else get in the way. I'm just so obsessed with, if my goal is exciting and honorable, then I should actually want to achieve it, and therefore, whatever it is that I need to do.
So, Tom, this is why. And this comes back to what makes, has made me really sad and deeply moved by the kinds of things that people are sharing. Most people aren't obsessed with their goals because they don't believe they're worthy of them. It's easy to dream about what you want, but in between where you are and what you want, there's a tremendous amount of stuff you got to change and do. And if you have a lot of trauma in your background, or you were raised by somebody who beat the shit out of you, or told you were a piece of shit, or if you've had to deal with microaggressions or racist, discriminatory, systematic crap your entire life, you have been given the message over and over and over, even though it's not true, that you don't deserve it, that there's something wrong with you. And if you don't, at some point, be defiant against what the world or your caregivers or your past experience has pounded into your brain incorrectly, unfairly, you will forever be stuck with that story. You are not responsible for what happened to you. You survived what happened to you. But you do have a responsibility to heal yourself and to do the work to change so that you can be the happy, fulfilled person that you were born to be.
Yeah, that's really powerful because it's the only thing that works. And, you know, thinking about so many people have just immense things that have happened that have been unfair, and as you said, they didn't do anything to deserve it, but now what? Now you're there, you've got the trauma, and no one can heal it for you. There's a name for it, I think it's called the pedestrian problem. It's like, imagine that you get hit by a car, and the driver was drunk, and let's say that the driver was Bill Gates, and let's say that you win a settlement, but if the damage that happened to your body can be fixed with all the money in the world, and you just have to do physical therapy, then it's like, even though it is unfair that you have to do the physical therapy, there is no amount of money that you can throw at it that will stop you from having to suffer to build yourself back up. And I think a lot of people either fall prey to trap number one, which is they don't think they're worthy, or they fall prey to trap number two, which is it's so unfair they just don't take action. But they're nonetheless in the situation that they're in, and if the whole punchline to life is neurochemistry and feeling joyful and, you know, being excited about who you are by yourself, then it's like, well, you have to do the work even if it isn't fair. And that's...
especially if it isn't. Because there's two kinds of prisons that you can sentence yourself to or be sentenced to, right? One is all the physical shit you're talking about. The circumstances of your life, the circumstances of your body,